And praise the Lord, dear brethren, our dear listeners and viewers that are following us online. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. I greet you all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. My name is Kobia Michobo, and I'm a preacher with the MCK Kawangware Circuit. I'm greatly humbled and honored because of this privilege of sharing God's words and God's word with us this evening. I therefore invite all of you and welcome you to join me as we share in this spiritual food that our Lord, our Father, has prepared for us this evening. So let us pray before we hear the word that will guide us this evening. Almighty Father, our Lord and our precious Father, we are praying in your presence this evening, and we thank you for this opportunity to hear your word. Lord, we pray that you will bless this word for us, so that Lord, we can bring forth fruits and benefits in our lives. We pray for your peace through the precious name of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So our theme tonight will be God's perfect knowledge of us. And we are going to read, our reading from the book of Psalms, chapter 139, verse 1, I will read up to 14, but during the free time, you may please read the whole chapter. God's complete knowledge and care. Lord, you have examined me and known me. You know everything I do. From far away, you understand all my thoughts. You see me whether I am walking or resting. You know all my actions even before I speak. You already know what I will say. Even before I speak, already know what I will say. You are all around me on every side. You protect me with your power. Your knowledge of me is too deep. It is beyond my understanding. Where could I go to escape from you? Where could I get away from your presence? If I went to heaven, you would be there. If I lay down in the world of the dead, you will be there, you will be there. If I flew away beyond the east or live in the farthest place in the west, you will be there to meet me. You will be there to help me. I could ask the dust in darkness to hide me, or the light around me to come into night. But even darkness is not dark for you, and the night is as bright as the day. Darkness and the light are the same to you. You created me, you created every part of me. You put me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because you are to be feared. All you do is strange and wonderful. I know it with all my heart. So that's our scripture for this evening. And as we meditate on this word, I would like to start with a question. Have you ever paused to ask yourself, who is God? We as Christians, we believe that God is one, but exists in three different persons. Persons in quotes. That is God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, which in Christian belief we call the Holy Trinity. So let us look at the attributes that describe the nature of God. The first attribute is, we are told God is omnipotence. That is, God is all-powerful. He created the whole world and everything that is in it. And And the work of creation continues even today. We are quite aware, I know many of us are aware, about a month ago we witnessed the volcanic eruption of a mountain called Wiradongo, which is 10 kilometers from the town of Goma in the DRC, Congo. It was fire from the ground, coming out with a liquid rock at very high speed. And we are told by the BBC report that the solids from the rocks were as high as three stories of a building. And they covered a huge area. Many buildings and many establishments around the town of Congo were covered with the lava, which later solidified to be rock. And when we see some of these happenings, we ask ourselves, who else can demonstrate such power? Is it a human being? There are many scriptures in the Bible that describe or that tell us or that bring out the aspect of God's power. This is probably a lesson for another day, a topic for another day. The second attribute is omnibenevolence. Omnibenevolence. God is all-loving. From the book of John 3:16, we learn that the deepest love one can show is to die for another. And God sacrificed his very own son for humanity. He loves all human beings in equal measure and without exception. The third attribute is just. God is fair and just. He is fair to all. And he forgives those who are sorry for their actions. This you can find in the book of Psalms, chapter 25 and verse 8. The fourth attribute is omniscience. Omniscience. God knows everything. The scripture that we have just read in the book of Psalms, 139, it tells us about God's knowledge about everything. The book of Matthew, chapter 10, verse 30, it tells us that God knows even the number of hair in our head. I have never heard of anyone who has ever counted the number of hairs in his head or even in another person's head. That is how deep God's knowledge is. This is not understanding that we are 7.8 billion people on this planet. And God can tell you the number of hairs in the end of each and every person. The fifth attribute is transcendence. This is to mean that God exists outside our worldly constraints and the physical laws of this world. He is eternal. And the psalmist, in verse 17 of this chapter that we have read, says, "O God, how difficult I find in your rocks." This is to me, complete understanding of God is beyond the human intellect. Clearly, it is not in the power of man to understand God's mind. The last attribute is immanence. This is to mean that God has interacted with the world throughout history and he continues to do so even today. There are many instances in the scripture which give us accounts of God's interaction with man. For example, Abraham, Noah, Moses, and even Jesus when he came here on earth. in the form of human, in the human body, and many other examples that tell us God has interacted with this world and he continues to do so even today. He performs miracles, he makes wonders for everyone to see that God exists and interacts with the world. Our theme today talks about God's perfect knowledge of us as human beings. And I'm quite sure that many of us know a gospel singer by the name Don Moen. He is one of my favorite gospel singers. His songs bless my heart a great deal. One of his songs that I love so much is titled, He Knows My Name. In this song, Don Moen tells us what inspired him to write this song, or to compose this song. He says that he was on a certain tour and he had visited a home for the elderly. And then as he moved from room to room, visiting the patients and giving them a word of encouragement. During this tour and his visit, he saw one old man who was sleeping and he was quarreling with the bed. You know how some of the quarrels, especially when you are in pain, when you quarrel on the, as if you are writing a letter C. That is how the old man would quarrel. And above the bed of this man, because every bed and the patient name written above it. So above the bed of this man, it was written, Mr. No Name. And so, Don Moen was a bit surprised that there is a person called Mr. No Name. And he asked the nurse who was with him whether this man didn't have a name. So the nurse said that they had found the man in the streets and they didn't know even how to communicate with him, because they didn't know the language he spoke. And so, John Moen took the man's hand and he said it to him, nobody knows your name here, but I know somebody who knows your name. God knows your name. This man may not have heard what the ones, or he may not have conceptualized the one that was spoken, but I'm quite sure the message was spiritually described somehow. And that is how the song, He Knows My Name, was inspired. And this song is derived from the text that we have read, Psalms 139. If you have some time, take time to go to the YouTube and listen to this beautiful and wonderful song, He Knows My Name. And they told this man, people in this hospital, people in the streets, and the people everywhere may not know your name, but I know of a person who knows your name, and God knows your name. Right now, and as we have said, the population in this world is around 7.8 billion. And all of these people, each one of them has a name. And some people are not happy with the names they were given. We find people who are happy with their names. And other times, depending on the culture, from one place to the other, there are times we are told that even the name of a person can determine the character of that person. And that person ends up even meeting the need. And so, there is a time I was employed in a certain organization, and there was a man in this organization who did not like his English name. Strange, he didn't know why. So many times he would omit the names altogether, the English name altogether, or he would use some abbreviations for this name. I never found out why he had tested this name this much. This was his official name, which was appearing in his all his identification, in all his certificates, but he would rarely use it. I don't know what name you have and what you feel about your name. Maybe you like it, maybe you hate it. Nonetheless, everyone likes to know that someone knows your name. Very important. Everyone likes to know that someone knows their name. And even if that person likes them, it's even much better. People attach a lot of importance to one's name. Nobody wants to be called by another name or by another person's name. Even the twins, even people who are born as twins, they have different names. A person's name is the greatest connection to their own identity and individuality. Some might even say it is the most important word in the world of that person. It is one way we can easily get someone's attention. It is a sign of courtesy and a way of recognizing someone. For those who may have read the play, it is in the book called Romeo and Juliet. You may be familiar with the phrase, "What's in a name?" And we see that Juliet is not allowed to associate with Romeo because he is a lunatic. So Juliet is complaining. And she says that Juliet is complaining and saying that Romeo's name actually is meaningless. That's what she says. And that Romeo would still be the same handsome young man even if he had a different name. That is why, or the origin of the popular phrase, says, "What's in a name?" There is one thing I would like us to know this evening. God calls us by our names, not the way the people of this world call us or recognize us, because God's knowledge about us is not the same as man's knowledge about us. God knows everything about us. And this is one of the most astonishing facts and a great comfort for any Christian, that God knows everything about us. I don't know which name the people of this world have given to you. Do they call you an ugly? Do they call you the poor? Or do they call you the rich? Do they call you the unlucky one? Or do they call you the imperfect? Do they call you the great one? Have they called you the lame? Many names. People will call you names. And sometimes what the people say about us can be a bother, and it can disturb us. People can cause us to have a false belief that we are something different from whom actually we are. And we have seen in a number of occasions, even in this country, even this town of ours, we have seen people committing suicide. We have seen many sinking into depression because of low self-esteem, because somebody maybe said that they are inadequate, because somebody said that you are condemned to be poor, maybe because somebody said you cannot make it in your studies, maybe because you got poor grades and you believe that that was the end of your life. There are many things that people and the world will say which will make us have a self and a false belief that we are actually that which is not us. And this evening, the one that I want to bring to you, God has sent me with this one. He says that he knows your name. And that's not all. God perfectly knows who you are. God calls you my sons and my daughters. That is what the book of 2 Corinthians tells us, chapter 6, verse 18. He says, I will be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. And the assurance in the book of Psalms 139 that we have read this evening is this. God has examined us and he knows us. He knows everything that we do. He understands our thoughts. He can see even whether we are working or we are resting. Even when you are sleeping, he knows our action. Even before we speak, even before I came to speak here tonight, God knew what I would say. He is around us. There is no sign of your time and we will not find God. And he is protecting us with his power. His knowledge about us is just too deep to understand. There is nowhere we can go to hide from God and to hide from his face. And so, dear friends, as I conclude my message this evening, let us hear what King David told his son Solomon in the book of 1 Chronicles, chapter 28 and verse 9. And I will read. David said this, and to Solomon he said, my son, I charge you to acknowledge your father's God, and to serve him with an inclined heart and a willing mind. He knows all our thoughts and desires. If you go to him, he will accept you. But if you turn away from him, he will abandon you forever. That is what David told his son Solomon on the day he communicated that Solomon would build the temple for God. This word is not only for Solomon, it is also for us this evening. Let us acknowledge this God. Let us serve him with an undivided heart and a willing mind. That is what he said. Serve your God, acknowledge him, serve him with an undivided heart and a willing mind. And God knows make choices. If you go to Him, He will accept us. But if we turn away from Him, He will reject us forever. It is not a good thing to be rejected, and more so by our Heavenly Father. Therefore, I urge each and one of us, let us go to this God who knows us, this God who knows everything about us. For there is nothing that can be hidden from Him. Don't ever deceive yourself that there is something you do in secrecy. Before God, there is no secrecy. Nothing can be hidden from Him. Search your mind. Examine yourself. Whatever you do, whether it's good or bad, bear in mind that God is watching. God is all around you. And His knowledge about you, no human mind can fathom. So dear brethren, everything in all creation is exposed and it lies open before God and before His eyes. That is what the Word of God says in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 19. I leave you tonight with one of the greatest assurances that we have got from the Psalms and from the Psalmist in the chapter 139. This is the greatest assurance that one can get. God knows your name. God knows everything about you. If you go to Him, He will give you a safe place. For there is no other safer place than in His presence. This is the word of God to us this evening. May the Lord bless you as you meditate upon it. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord Almighty, we thank you this evening. Thank you for the one that has come to us. Help us, Lord, to understand that there is no place in heaven, in this universe, on earth, that you can go and hide from. That you understand and you know even every difficulty we go through. You know every bit of our life. And God, Lord, we pray that you help us through your Holy Spirit to accept you, Father, and to come to you because you are a safe refuge. Any other place, we will not get any help. We pray that, Father, you give us. May you continue to do that which you have destined for us, for you know every detail about our lives. And it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
And now please.